It's been a hard road to get back there because we believe we were cheated out of the World Heavyweight Championship. I've watched it over and over again. I've listened to the radio comments over and over again on it. And I would say it was more of a shock. If you actually study the fight and slow it down into slow motion, you will see McCall actually threw the shot in desperation. His eyes were closed and he was going backwards. And Lennox had committed himself, and McCall's natural punch, if you watch any of his fights, is just to throw a right hand. And he just threw the right hand. And unfortunately, Lennox Lewis had committed himself and come off balance and had fallen forward. And there was only one place McCall's right hand could go, and that was straight onto Lennox's chin, and that's where it landed up.
I think that Lewis is going to win by a distance fight, points decision, or late stoppage.
McGlare with no hype at all attached, just total meaning. This is the moment of destiny, perhaps, for Oliver McCall from Chicago. The number one challenger, can Lennox see him off? The referee from Mexico, Jose Guadalupe Garcia. Three judges who will judge this fight. Well, first off, the atomic bull hasn't come charging out.
No, he's not. He's not his usual hyped up aggressive self. He's playing it safe at the moment. Blinking and frowning there at Lewis. Lewis, again, taking the centre of the ring. They're just pawing at each other, trying to measure their distance. And Lewis had tried to load it up with a good left hook there. McCall, unusually going back and using his jab, trying to be smart. I did see that, you know, they told us that he was going to run out and attack Lewis from the start, but that's something like Emmanuel Stewart would tell you. He gives you the wrong tactics completely. He's a great strategist, and obviously this guy's going to play a little cuter again. But Lewis effectively using that jab.
It must be murder for McCall to have these tactics. He's instinctively such an aggressive fighter and so charged up as he is to play it so contained.
Yes, well, he looks so charged up, and it must have been difficult for them to get him to do this in the first few rounds, but they're looking a little bit apprehensive there when he attacked Lewis. Lewis looks as poised as ever and in control.
Yes, I don't think the emotion's left McCall yet. It may do in a couple of rounds, but he's still very, very tight.
Yeah, he's stiffened, and you know, he's, I'm sure, full of tension and full of adrenaline, and that can help you, and if you let it overcome you, it can be the worst thing possible for you. So it remains to be seen if he's loosened out yet, but he's a good fighter up close, and he's hit Lewis with a good right hand around the side and a left uppercut. Tried the right hand again, missed, and McCall came back with his own right hand to the body. This guy's very strong, very physically strong, Oliver McCall, up close. So Lennox will not want to fight with him on the inside. That's where his best game plan will be. You've got to get him at a distance, use that quick jab, and not allow him to get off on him.
The bull, they call him, he's built like an ox.
Yeah, built very strong indeed. He's a great offensive fighter, which, as I said, if he gets over these first couple of rounds, could cause Lewis all sorts of problems. Lewis doesn't like to be forced back and doesn't like to lose the initiative, likes to take control of the fight, and this guy's forcing him to take a step back every now and again. Oh, Lewis tried that big booming right hand over the top. He wants to win in style here.
Just away from the chin. McCall took it well, though, didn't flinch. Remember, McCall has never been down. First round close, but yeah, probably to Lewis, the jab working, and he just did enough to show it, I think.
Yeah, he just imposed himself a little bit more on McCall, and looked, you know, just have shaded the round, very close round all the same.
So McCall there with his 24 wins out of 29 fights, 17 inside the distance, turned pro in 1985. He lost his first pro fight to Mike Hunter, but hasn't he come on since, and Lennox an unblemished record with 21 KOs. as we said, bang on 238, 17 stone, his heaviest ever fighting weight. Pepe Correa in front of him, his main trainer, who was non-stop. The Lennox corner is just, what, 2 metres in front of where Barry and I are sitting. And Correa is constantly buzzing, exhorting his man on.
Carrera said, let the jab be the key. Use the jab, that's the key to everything, which is absolutely right. You can't afford to get up and just load up on this guy without jabbing first, because, oh! And Lewis is down! Oh, what a right hand! He's in big trouble here, Simon.
Just walked onto it, and he is in desperate trouble. His legs are shaky. It's over! It is over! Lennox Lewis has gone, and Oliver McCall is the new world heavyweight champion. Lennox is saying, what happened? Why did he stop it? But he was in no position to defend himself. One big right hand was enough, and it was McCall's night of destiny.
I think it was a situation where I exposed myself. You know, I just went out there and my mindset was just to go out there and destroy him, because, you know, he was shooting off his mouth in the earlier press conferences. I just wanted to go out there and land my right hand, because I knew if I put, all my power behind my right hand that and hit him, that it would all be over really quick. And I went out there and I threw a left hook and a right hand at the same time he was throwing a left hook. But, you know, not realizing the punch that he caught me with was a very natural punch for him, where, you know, he almost threw this punch in a fit of scaredness. He must have realized that my right hand was coming, and he just closed his eyes and moved like he naturally does, and threw his right hand in return. At that time, my body was way in front of myself. And my balance is way ahead of myself, and he just caught me right on the button. And it's like I helped him to knock me down.
We're talking about this long road back. It was September 94, nearly 2.5 years to when you're getting back in the ring. Did you honestly think it was going to take you 2.5 years to get to the mat?
No. I felt that, okay, Oliver McCall would have one fight and then fight me once again, but with the trials and tribulations of boxing, this is how the politics and people can affect the sport. And there's all kinds of different things that have stopped me getting that one chance or that one fight back, obviously, with Oliver McCall, or even getting the WBC belt back. I think, in a sense, things happen for a reason. I can't really blame one thing.
What did you learn from that fight? Was it that you weren't undefeatable, that you weren't all-powerful, that you could lose?
Oh, yeah. Like I said, there's always that chance of me losing. I think I learned a great deal. It really helped me, because if I would have went through that fight and beat Oliver McCall, I think, you know, I may have gone down another bad road somewhere. So in a sense, this was like a teaching process for me. It helped me to realize the team around me wasn't as tight as I would have wanted it. My trainer wasn't as good as I thought he was. Not to totally believe in him, because he wasn't really the right trainer for me at the time. Certain people around me weren't the right people around me. And, obviously making the right decisions and correcting the world around Lennox Lewis and making it a lot better, so next time when I go in the ring, step in the ring, I have a stronger team around me that's going to help me, you know, get what I'm after.
And one of the positive things that came out of that, and talking about the team, is that the man who trained Oliver McCall for your next fight was in fact your trainer.
Yeah.
Emmanuel Stewart, who's trained 24 champions, I believe.
Yes.
What do you think he's done for you?
Emmanuel Stewart is—it's funny getting into professional boxing from the amateurs, and going through one trainer, and that trainer will teach you a certain thing, then going through another trainer, and he will teach you a certain thing. All of a sudden, reaching and getting with Emmanuel Stewart, it seemed like we were made for each other, because he had such a knowledge of the game, such experience out there, and he was one of the, he's a trainer that he would speak, and all of a sudden, I would listen and I could understand and actually do what he would want or what he was telling me to do.
All while I've been training the other heavyweights that I've had, Michael Moore and Evander Holyfield, I always, you know, let it be known to everyone that my favorite heavyweight in the world was always Lennox Lewis. And in fact, they used to even tease me about it, and Oliver McCall included. And when I got a phone call after the McCall and Lennox Lewis fight, I seriously thought about it for a moment. I had never made any verbal agreement or written agreement with any of the other heavyweights that I had trained to win championships, because I never really wanted to be tied down. And when I received a call related to training Lennox, I thought about it for a while, even though at the time I was handling the heavyweight champion of the world, which was Oliver McCall. And I looked upon it as a challenge. And I went to meet with Lennox and Panos Eliades and Frank Maloney. And after the meeting, I had a good feeling. And we worked out in a gym. It's very good chemistry between Lennox and I. And I decided that I was going to do it and give up Oliver McCall, who was a heavyweight champion, because I believed that Lennox would win the championship again. And it would be a chance for me to go on and really to take one major project and see if I can make him become the best all-around heavyweight in the history of boxing. When Lennox and I was training for the first fight together, which was with Lionel Butler, which was his first fight following the defeat to Oliver McCall also, you could tell there was still a lot of uneasiness and unsureness about him. Because in fighting Butler, who was mandated as the mandatory guy that he had to fight in order to get a chance to fight back for the title, he was fighting a guy who was also promoted and handled by Don King, basically known as a street type person who had no discipline, who was basically in a lot of ways very similar to Oliver McCall. And when we got to the ring that night, it was the same type situation. The guys that was in his corner, one of them was his former trainer, Pepe Carrera, who said some very derogatory things to him in the center of the ring, which I thought was disgusting. And you could tell that Lennox, based on all of this, was really very uncomfortable with the entire situation. And he was not sure of himself neither, until I think about two rounds before he finally got his confidence up. And then he went to work. I think that was the most difficult fight that he's had in his career at this point in time right now.
In a sense, it was a little difficult because, you know, coming off of a knockout, people felt that, oh, Lennox Lewis's chin isn't there anymore. And everybody expected Lionel Butler to come out there and knock me out and do the same thing. So I was, in a sense, apprehensive in a way. I didn't really want to get hit, but yet go out there and prove that I can outbox Lionel Butler, and that Lionel Butler really wasn't nothing to me. And it was a big step for people said, because, you know, they say, why would I go in against a guy that, you know, was known for knocking people out? I wanted to really prove myself and prove that, you know, the day with Oliver McCall was a lucky punch, and that Lennox Lewis still has a great chin and can go out there and still win and still is a champion.
This is round number five. A lot of water in the corner of Lionel Butler. Quick knockdown. Caught Lionel Butler, I believe, off balance. His feet were together. I don't think he was really hurt. Flash knockdown in the early part of this round. Lewis pawing with the jab. Notice when he throws his jab, folks, he doesn't bring it back like he should. When you throw your jab, you should bring it back to your chin like it was on a rubber band. But Lennox drops his jab, a la Tommy Hines, that's how you get countered with the right hand. Lennox trying to hammer home that right hand. Getting mugged inside a little bit. Marty Denken won him Butler for his brawl. Whoa! What was that?
line, a brother threw a big haymaker and fell down. That's what happens when you throw those haymakers with your feet together. Lennox Lewis landing his most powerful punches in the last round and then knocking Lionel Butler down at the beginning of this, the fifth round. Butler backing up a lot now, sucking wind, starting to show some swelling on the right eye. Little note on Lionel Butler, he was the number one pick to play Mike Tyson in the HBO movie. This came out a couple months ago, last month. And the bottom line was, although he looked like Tyson when he was about 30 pounds lighter, he couldn't act to save his life. He broke the other actor's nose in the very first round of practicing for the movie. So he was out. Butler, not doing much. Is he trying to lure Lennox Lewis in? Lennox going with the left right there. All Lennox Lewis in this, the fifth round. Scheduled for 12. A WBC heavyweight title eliminator. I'm Pedro Fernandez. It's a pleasure to call the action for you tonight live from the Arco Arena in Sacramento, California. Oh, 30 seconds to go in this, the fifth round, scheduled for 12. Lewis already won this round. I wouldn't call it a round that he would put in the album. In fact, here comes the crowd getting on, and they want to see some action. A lot of people thought that right hand had something on it by Lennox Lewis. It didn't. 10 seconds to go, and this is fifth round. Butler takes two shots. It's all over. Referee Marty Dagan has stopped the fight. The fight has been stopped. At the end of the fifth round, a surprise stoppage. Lennox Lewis landing the right hand. The ringside doctors are with Lionel Butler right now. Might have been a bit of a quick call by Marty Dinkin. We're not going to question the referee who's been involved in more than 100 world title fights. As we wind up the tape, we're going to hear from him. Here goes the left, first left down. Ooh, bang. First knockdown is about 10 seconds into the round right there. Not a whole lot on it. And this is it, the knockout punch. The stoppage. Painted with the left hand on the body, right hand. Oh, that right hand didn't even land. Didn't even look like it landed. Went on the, oh. Well, I really think that that fight was called a little bit too soon by Marty Dinkin. And I think Lionel Butler was acting a little bit because he didn't look like he got hit solid with that shot. Looked like he was looking for a place to fall, folks. Straight up, Lionel Butler probably not in the best condition tonight, 261 pounds. But he makes $750,000 here tonight as he exits the ring. A loser. So, Lionel Butler's record falls to 23-11. Lennox Lewis moves his record to 25-1, recording his 22nd knockout. Look at Butler going to his corner. Referee Marty Dinkin. I'm sure the press is going to want to ask him a few questions after this play. All right, we're waiting on Jim Hall for the official decision on the time of the knockout. Jim Hall, a radio personality here in the Sacramento area, one of the best ring announcers in the business, no question about that. Mr. Voice here in Sacramento, Jim Hall. Lewis, ecstatic. The Lewis corner is ecstatic. Emmanuel Stewart, they're all happy. They're happy over the result. But I don't think they would be happy over the entire fight. The fight is not something you want to take home to mom. Although mom, if Lennox Lewis, his mom is in his corner, you know. Quick end to tonight's fight, folks. Who expected to end that quickly? I mean, boom, bang, it's over. And I'd like to get another shot of that punch, another angle on that last punch that hit Lionel Butler. See if the punch really landed that clean. Let's go to Jim Hall.
Winner of this WBC heavyweight title eliminator bout at 2 minutes and 55 seconds of the fifth round. Winner by knockout, Lennox Lewis.
Lennox Lewis, the winner. KO round five, 202 minutes minutes and 55 seconds. What can you say? Lennox Lewis stopped his man. He's now 26-1 with 22 knockouts. Remains the top-rated contender in the WBC. And will be looking for a title fight very soon. No question about that.
Lennox Lewis, many congratulations. A tremendous performance. And the nightmare of Oliver McCall must have disappeared.
Definitely. This was a fight preparing for Oliver McCall. And the same way I boxed there, I'm going to box the same way when I box Oliver McCall again, because I want my title back.
He came out in the first round a bit like Oliver McCall.
Yeah, he did. You know, I learned from my mistakes, and I was definitely prepared for him to come out like that, because he's got a very tenacious style. So I made sure that I was on my P's and Q's.
At the end of the fourth round, the advice in the corner was, you're letting the fight go at his pace, step it up to your own pace, and that's exactly what happened.
Yeah, basically, I realized that he was getting tired, because he weighs 260 pounds, and I realized that 260 pounds can't touch this. So as long as I stepped it up a bit, then he was out of his realm.
How much of a difference, to be honest, did having Emmanuel Stewart in your corner really make?
A big difference, because he's a good tactician. We go in there with some strategy, and we basically pull out great performances like that.
This man, Butler, was reckoned, apart from Mike Tyson, to be perhaps the most dangerous man in world boxing. You've now beaten him in pretty spectacular fashion. You must be due a rematch with Oliver McCall.
Oh, I'm definitely preparing for that. And if Oliver's listening, you're the one I'm waiting for. I think the main thing is learning. Is the learning curve, the learning with Oliver McCall, realizing that, you know, go out there and pep him up with the jab first, don't be in such a rush, because when I was in a rush, Oliver McCall was still, you know, still very hyped, and that's why I was caught with that right hand, in a sense, because I took a chance too early. Now, in the Lionel Butler fight, I felt that I need to go out there and go, you know, work behind my jab, move around, get him tired after a couple of rounds, and then get into my fighting.
Well, it certainly paid off, because you dispatched him in the fifth round. The fight after that was with Justin Fortune in Dublin. Can you tell us a little bit about that fight again? He got rid of him in the fourth round, but how did Justin differ to Lionel Butler? How did that? The second fight after the loss to Oliver McCall, were you feeling more confident, more strong?
I was feeling more confident. In that fight, I did a lot more natural things. You see, each fight is always difficult for me, because I realize that, you know, this person's looking at, oh, Lennox Lewis can be knocked out, and they're coming out to prove themselves. Maybe Justin Fortune never had a big name, but he wanted to make a big name for himself. So I wasn't out taking any chances, because I realized everybody's watching, but yet everybody's saying, oh, Justin Fortune's not that good. But then there's always that chance that, you know, he may catch me with a lucky punch, and all of a sudden, there, Justin Fortune is on the platform.
In the red corner, wearing the white trunks with the gold trim, and coming from London, from 27 professional contests, he has 26 wins, 22 by way of KO, with just one loss. He weighed in at 8 pounds and even 246 pounds. He is ranked number one by both the WBO and the WBC. He's the former British, Commonwealth and European and WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Lennox Lewis.
A huge roar of welcome for the former WBC champion Lennox Lewis. A nice touch too, carrying an Irish tricolour into the ring. And we're now seconds away from the main event of the evening here at the Point Theatre in Dublin.
The officials in charge, Mr. Nick Moore and Mr. Mel Crystal, President of the Boxing Union of Ireland, the timekeeper, Mr. Dale Elliott, and your referee, Mr. Roy Francis from London.
The referee this evening, a WBC official, duly appointed. There's Manny Stewart and Freddie Roach, the trainers in the ring. Just look at that difference in height now between the two. He's not even up to Lewis's shoulders. Big fight referee now explaining the rules, but that's all been done in the dressing room. That's merely for show. And we're seconds away now from this round, opening round of this scheduled 10-rounder between Lennox Lewis and Justin Fortune. Seconds are just out of the ring now. Manny Stewart counting down. And his mom, of course, ringside, as she always is, Gladys Lewis, for all his big fights. So Fortune at a tremendous disadvantage here now, on height and reach. He certainly coming forward. Oh, he's rocked already. Straight left from Lewis. Fortune predicting the week during the week that after the Oliver Paul fight, Lewis is gun shy. Meaning that he can no longer take a punch to the chin. Fortune will be hoping that's true and hoping for a sweeping right hook. Apparently an uppercut. You would hope would take Lewis out of it. Back in the days of Joe Frazier, was supposed to ask big heavyweight champion, that was a small man. Didn't bother him too much, he just went out there and demolished people. Tyson, of course, a small man at 5'11". A fortune smaller than even the two of them. Lewis can afford to stand back and have Fortune come on. Fortune wants to try and weave into that massive reach of Lewis. Lewis should be able to pick him off with ease then if he can. Well, in fairness to Fortune, he's doing what he said he would. He saw it. Good right hook to the body. He's bringing the fight to Lewis like he said he would. Let's have Lewis get out of that way. This, of course, would be one of the biggest upsets if Fortune were to pull it off. Well, he's certainly bringing the fight to Lewis. Certainly mixing it. Yeah, you can see the difference in height and the difference in reach. Lewis, of course, had a successful comeback fight after that McCall defeat when he beat Lionel Butler in five rounds, which is an eliminator for the WBC title. And Fortune will be winning. Big support here if he keeps this up. Everybody loves the underdog and certainly shaping up. Though he needs to in the early rounds, because the longer it goes, I fear, the more it will suit the former champion, Lennox Lewis. Oh, a clubbing right hand there as he held him. Get in there and break him, referee, that's it. Lewis trying to weigh his man down, which is very tiring for fighters. He can push his head down. Lewis trying to hold his head there, the referee telling him not to. And certainly looks like he can bang. He's got massive arms. All those years of weight fighting. The American network covering the fight actually picked Fortune for this fight. Oh yeah, the end of round one. They said that he would be a far better contender. Young and hungry and ambitious. And they're usually the most dangerous. Fortune. So, away we go. To round four. He was comfortably ahead in points at this stage. Now, Fortune certainly didn't have any favours in the opening round. And who knows, may even have swung it. Now you can see the difficulty Lewis has. Trying to find the reach of the little man. It's awkward. He's getting through now though. Some good shots there from Lewis. Good combination. There's a left-right left that connects again. Lewis hiding comfortably behind that left jab. All that reach, all he's got to do is snake it out and stay behind it, and he'll certainly be comfortable. Getting close now. Fortune wants, he needs to get in close and then hope, bouncing off the clinches, that he can connect. Through one punch there and took three from Lewis in return, which is always going to be the problem for the smaller man. Apologising to Lewis for that low blow. Danny Stewart said earlier in the week, Lewis is one of the best sportsmen he's ever worked with. It's three right hooks, three uppercuts rather. Bang, 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 and the referee has stopped it. His man has taken enough punishment. The Fortune is, he doesn't look too happy about the decision, but his face is badly cut over his left eye. was a bad gash there, blood starting to seep from it. And Lewis is camp and needs to be jumping into the ring. The entire entourage, Kojak, a man in a hat, he's head of security. Referee holds Lewis's hat aloft. And he continues with his quest to regain the WBC heavyweight title once again. Oliver McCall is his next scheduled fight, we're told. But they may have to go through the courts to get that one settled, because McCall is down to fight Frank Bruno at Wembley Stadium on the 2nd of September, if we can believe what we're reading and hearing. There's that big right hook again, and the uppercut. One, two, and the referee has no option but to jump in. Fortune looking concussed. I really fear that perhaps the cynics were right. Mel Crystal, let's look at that action again, brother. There's that big uppercut again, and bang, his Fortune's head rocked. I just see Mel Crystal, who's president of the Boxing Union of Ireland, consoling Fortune and explaining to him just why the fight was stopped. Fortune clearly isn't happy with his decision, but it really was only a matter of time. He said he was coming into this fight with the intention to bring it to Lewis. He wasn't worried about a height disadvantage, and he hoped for a surprise or two. Sadly, that didn't happen, although in fairness, he certainly started with a frenzy, but he never really had a chance against Lewis. 9 inches taller, and with a far, far bigger reach. He's trying to there, Freddie Roach consoling him. You get a shot down a minute, you'll see just that, the nick under his left eyebrow. There's a mixed reaction from the crowd to this decision. Some booing, during the referee jumped in a mite too early. But I think in the morning, Justin Fortune will decide, like, and he's time to reflect about it. Maybe the referee was right. A lot of sweating there around the eye. And you can see the gash there. Bruising starting to come up. That'll be a real old shining now in the morning. He'll be wandering around the Gresham Hotel here in Dublin with his sunglasses on, I've no doubt. Lewis obviously very happy with his work. But again, he's on a loser. Why didn't he put him away in the first and the second round? It'd be the question. The two fighters shaking hands there now. Fortune says his dream is to open a French restaurant. He's a qualified chef. I'm sure that dream will be easier to realize than his dream of winning the world heavyweight title. There's the mixed reaction now to the official announcement. That sort of says what the fans think anyway. They're quite unhappy, as is Justin Fortune, with that decision to stop the fight. Lewis threw 117 punches to Fortune's 75. 82 of them landed. Fortune landing just 19 punches in the four rounds of the fight happened. A success rate of 25% compared to Lewis's 70%. Lewis will be happy with his night's work, I'm sure. As he gets ready now to fight, hopefully Oliver McCall, for him that is.
He threw some good punches, and his, you know, I hit him with some tremendous shots. It was surprising that he didn't go down, but I knew the uppercuts would get to him.
The size, with his size, he was awkward. Once you sort of sussed him out, you fell into your game plan, didn't you?
Definitely. I was a bit cautious the first round. Then a man, you told me to step it up, so I did.
Did he hurt you at all with some of them shots?
No, he actually caught me in the first round with a good shot, and that kind of woke me up, so I started rattling my punches.
If you have a look over your right shoulder, we show you the finish. Just talk us through it. These uppercuts were tremendous.
Yeah, definitely. I seen every time he got hurt, I would just throw the uppercut, and he was really open for the uppercut. So I was trying to launch into some uppercuts. But like I said, he was pretty tough. I was just about going to come out on the left hook, and the referee said stop. He was trying to win a lot of punches in there, but I figured I'd just step aside and throw the uppercut. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I said to the referee, you did a good job. I didn't want to get him too hurt in there.
Yeah, they booed the stoppage, but that's fair. I mean, you got to stop a guy like that from getting hurt bad.
Definitely. You know, a guy that has a big heart, they always get hurt, so I didn't want to hurt him too bad.
Now, I have to ask Frank Maloney, what is the situation with regard to this man getting a shot at a world title?
We will do all possible now to lodge his claim of the WBC. We've also been informed that he's the number one in the WBO, so that makes him the mandatory for Riddick Bowe as well. So now we have two angles to pursue. But the WBC is the most important angle.
Foreman, I believe, has given up the IBF. Is that another option?
No, that's been made by, I believe, the German and the South African.
So give me a time scale. How long before we see Lennox Lewis fighting for a world title?
Well, we will definitely see Lennox Lewis in the ring by the end of September, October, and we're hoping that's going to be for the world title.
Well, that's something we all look forward to. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much.
The Tommy Morrison fight, it was an interesting fight, you know, looking back at the tape, I felt I could have knocked him out in two rounds. But realizing that, you know, I was doing so well in the fight and everything was going my way, it lasted to the sixth round. So, you know, there's a lot of different things that I was practicing in that fight. And I was basically taking my time and looking like a professional, looking like, yeah, Lennox Lewis is still here. And I was having, not in a sense having fun, but I was enjoying the boxing aspect of it, the fact that everything was going my way.
I'd say you were having fun. I mean, you knocked him down four times with different punches, a left to the temple, an uppercut, a jab from the right hand. Watching that fight, you seemed to really enjoy yourself.
I was enjoying the fact that things that I was working on in the gym were actually coming to play, and I was actually doing them in the ring.
It may not be there tonight.
He needs a grand slam at this point.
But there's nobody on base.
That's true.
Clubbing right by Lewis. Big uppercut by Lewis. Morrison keeps coming. These are big shots.
I don't know if Morrison has the power. That's about it.
That's got to be the fight. But Morrison is up.
It's a gutty fighter, but he's overmatched right now. It's getting to the point where it's dangerous. Well, I think Mills should stop it, and he did.
That's it. That's two knockdowns in this round. A total of four overall.
The Ray Mercer fight was an interesting fight. It was a fight where I trained in the 20-foot ring. All of a sudden, I was brought to New York, boxed him in his hometown, and they put me in an 18-foot ring. So it felt like I had, in that fight, it felt like I, you know, all of a sudden they put me in a little telephone booth, and it's like I had to fight more than box. Not to really say, you know, blame the ring for it. We both had the same conditions, but it was more set for his advantage more than anything. He had he bought out the first two rows, front rows. So every time he would make any punches or throw any kind of wild punches my way, the crowd would go mad. His crowd would go mad.
Let's move on to the reason why we're all here, and that's the 7th of February, Hilton International, Las Vegas. Tell us a bit about the preparation, not only physically but mentally, for this fight, because it is special, isn't it, Lennox?
Yeah, you know, this fight's special for me because it's like round two. It's like the continuation of what was supposed to happen if the referee would have allowed us to continue boxing. Basically, people are asking me, are you worried or this and that? I'm not really worried, but I'm not worried about anything. I just want to go in there and do what comes natural and do what I always wanted to do. Because when I look back at Oliver McCall and I look back at, you know, even his recent fights, I said, this guy beat me. I can definitely beat this guy. And I want to go out there and just do that, just accomplish it. You know, people said, you want to go knock him out? If the knockout is there, I'll take it, definitely. But I just want to go in there and just prove that this man can't beat me, that it was a lucky punch, and he definitely can't knock me out.
Mentally, everybody says you're ready for it. Physically, what are you doing to prepare for it? We've seen some of the sparring today. Can you talk us a little bit through the training program that you're going through?
Yeah, in the morning time, I go for a run. That switches up every different day. Right now, I'm running on the golf course, and probably tomorrow I'll be running up a hill, doing some hill work. After that, I come prepare myself for the afternoon session, which involves sparring, a lot of technical stuff. I've been working a lot of technical stuff for this fight because, like I said, there's certain things that Oliver McCall does I want to be definitely prepared for. Speed bag work. At nighttime, we may do some sit-ups and push-ups and watch some tapes.
I know that Emmanuel is very vocal, and he's also... you couldn't say Emmanuel's a modest guy either. I got the impression that it wasn't for our benefit that he was shouting a lot of instructions to you today. Do you find that useful?
Very useful. it's like, it's good to see when Emmanuel's in the ring with you, because like he may talk and is thinking along with me. He sees me thinking, he sees me attempt certain things and said, yeah, that's right, throw that, come back with that, that's right, do that. You know, he's right there in the same mindset I'm in. So it helps me even when he's in my corner and the fight's going on. He may say, yeah, do that left thing, left right hand thing you do or something. And I know exactly what he's talking about because we've trained for it. He's into the training with me. Also, all of a sudden, I may be the one in the ring, but yet he's in there mentally with me, because when I go back to the corner, he may tell me one thing or two things, and I know exactly what he's talking about. And he knows that I can actually do these things because he knows what I'm capable of.
So mentally you're prepared, physically you're prepared. Will the training regime change? You've mentioned that you're changing your running. What else will change as the fight day gets nearer?
As the fight day gets closer, I mean, the running definitely may change. We'll be doing more sprints and as far as boxing goes, we might go a little longer rounds. As we get closer to the fight, it gets more intense. And I would say the last week of the fight, we kind of chill out and relax a bit more.
When will you stop sparring with people like Julius Francis?
I like sparring right up to about a week before the fight. And the reason is definitely don't want to go in there and get any injuries and not be 100% for your fight. Always want to be 100%. That's basically it. Do a lot more shadow boxing, a lot more speed work, a lot more combinations, so we have that mindset. I think the mental preparation is going to be a lot deeper. I'll be focusing even more, fine-tuning my focusing.
People say it couldn't be done. The way that you want to win, even when you're playing pitch and putt out there, it's Lennox has got to be the champion in all that he does.
Oh yeah, I'm very competitive. Everything I do, whether it's an argument, even when it comes down to an argument, sometimes I don't even bother because I've won already.
Fine. Just getting back to this fight, we talked about the mental preparation, the physical preparation, but this fight is more, not just for you, because there seems to be a bad feeling between the Maloney Lennox camp and Don King and Oliver McCall's side. Will that help you in your fight on the 7th, or will it hinder you?
I think it'll help me. And I'm not really worried about their side. You know, I realize that their side is always shooting their mouths off and arguing about something and never happy about anything. I'm just concentrating on what I want to accomplish and just go out there and do it. As far as what they've got a lot of problems, and I think their problems are due because of how they just exist through everyday life. And I'm not really concerned about it. All I'm concerned about is Oliver McCall being in the ring. Don King won't be in the ring with him, just he will.
We always set up a training camp in the United States. One reason is because we believe the facilities and the conditions are far better in the United States. Sparring partners are easy to get access to, and it seems that the United States cater for athletes, unlike our own country, Britain. We normally train on the East Coast. The reason to move to the West Coast here at Phoenix, the Camelback Inn, was because the fight had been transferred to Las Vegas, Nevada, which is 45 minutes from here, and the time difference is the same. And that was one of the reasons. Also, the sort of conditions and the climate is the same. It's desert here, dry heat, and chilly at the evenings, exactly the same as Nevada. And for the best preparations for Lennox Lewis, we brought him here, so that when it was time to move to Vegas, there was no major adjustments for the body to accept or to make.
My role in regards to Lennox's career is that I organize and implement all his training programs, his diet, so I do a little bit of the nutrition stuff. Now, how I work with the team is we all sit down every night and work out what Lennox is going to be doing the next day. I then try to make sure that he's not being overworked, because I find with most boxers, they tend to overwork themselves. They go on, they run 6 miles every day, they're doing X amount of rounds in the gym, and they're not doing anything to build their strength back up. All they do boxers are creatures of habits. They look back at the old fighters, say they used to run X amount of miles in boxes. All I'm going to do are chop woods or crack boulders or whatever. Well, what I do is I take Lennox's ability as a natural athlete and make sure that he's using it to his fullest potential. Like all the other athletes in the world, we do a lot of different activities, whether it be weights, swimming, cycling, not just running like most boxers do.
How does he take training? Does he enjoy it, or is it like a bit of hard work for him?
No, well, we make it enjoyable. You know, the thing is, all the guys that are with Lennox, we've been together with him so long that we know each other. When we're out running, we're running for the first mile or two, we're all laughing, talking about whatever sporting event we watched or whatever TV program was on or whatever, and then eventually we get down to where it's really serious, no one's talking, and we just do it. We all feed off of each other, and we all understand each other so well that there doesn't need to be a thing where we have to drive him or he has to drive us. We all understand each other enough to know, okay, after X amount of miles or whatever, we know, okay, we're going to get serious. We're going to start pushing, and we just do it. Lennox doesn't need to be pushed because, as I said, he's so competitive.
He seems a very competitive guy, whatever he's doing, whether he's playing pool or tennis.
Yeah, that's the thing that a lot of people don't realize about Lennox. Everybody always says he's too laid back. The thing they don't realize is Lennox is extremely competitive. I think because of the skill levels he has and all the different sports he does, the capacity to go further than most normal people would do to win, that's what sets him apart from most of the guys that are in the sport, most of the top guys anyways.
We're privileged to be with Arnie Beam, the man who brought Lennox Lewis into the world of boxing. How did it all start, Arnie?
It all started when Lennox came down with a couple of his friends to our boxing gym in Kitchener, which is called the Waller Regional Police Association Boxing Club, and he stood out immediately as a little bigger than the others and showed an interest. And the biggest thing I noticed, the most important thing I noticed, that he listened. He would look at you and hang on to every word that you said. He was the kind of person that would listen rather than talk.
You must have felt very proud seeing him on the podium in the number one spot for the gold medal at Seoul Olympics in 88.
I don't think I have ever been that proud. The feeling is just indescribable. But you're right, there were tears in my eyes. He was in Seoul, I was in Canada, but I'm sure he could see the tears in my eyes because I was so proud of him.
I know he's been like a son to you for most of his grown-up life. What will he be thinking as he goes into the ring?
Well, I hope he remembers some of the things I taught him. Important going into a bout of this nature to be awake, be alert, be aware every moment of that bout. Because one second's inattention and it can be over and it can have disastrous results. But I'm sure he'll be thinking that and he'll be focused. As I said previously, he doesn't make the same mistake twice, so I'm looking forward to the next winning.
I basically want to go out there and just prove myself, utilize my talents. I've got an arsenal filled with punches I can throw at any given moment. I just want to go out there and just do it. I think this is a very important fight for me, another step for me, and once I can regain that WBC belt, I can go after the rest, and this is what I aim to do.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the home of excitement and the world's new home for championship boxing. Welcome to the Las Vegas Hilton. In the beginning, there was the desert. Then, from its dry earth, Las Vegas was born. 6 decades later, the Las Vegas Hilton soared into the sky and into the future. Through the years, in its ring, the Las Vegas Hilton has hosted the greatest legends in the world's greatest sport, boxing. Legends like Ali, Phoenix, Holmes, Douglas, Foreman, and Tyson. They arrived armed only with strength and pride. They left either bloodied and defeated or as champions of the world. Hours from now, all the power, all the excitement, and all of the glory return. New legends will be made. Boxing is back at the Las Vegas Hilton. This time, it's payback or playback for Lennox Lewis and Oliver McCall. The two come in a quest for glory, honor, and the WBC heavyweight title. Lewis is looking for payback after judges called the 94 fight in favor of McCall. McCall is looking to play back 94 and once again defeat Lewis to take home the title. Finally, boxing returns to its home, the home where bones have been broken, egos have been shattered, men have been conquered, and champions have been made. Welcome to the Las Vegas Hilton.
Principal and really the only investor in Lennox Lewis. Tell us just what happened in the past which has brought you along to this stage.
Well, from the initial stages where I invested to buy Lennox's contract, he was cruising along very smoothly. He beat everybody before him until he met Oliver McCall in September of 94 when he was unfortunate, he got a bit careless and he was knocked down. I mean, that fight actually cost me. We had a contract signed to fight Riddick Bowe for $35 million. That must be the most expensive punch in the history of boxing because that cost the team actually $35 million that punch.
How are things running for this fight? Can we talk about monies?
The money in this fight is no big monies. I mean, we're talking less than $10 million. It's a very important fight because this fight will put Lennox back as the world heavyweight champion. From there, I think people like Evander Holyfield, Mike Tyson, Michael Mora have to fight Lennox to prove to the world that they are the best boxers in the world. They're only kidding themselves if they fight each other without really fighting Lennox, because all these boxers are really not big heavyweights. They're cruiserweights that have been ballooned up to heavyweights. Lennox is a true heavyweight. I mean, he weighed in today at 251. He is a true heavyweight and hasn't got an ounce of fat on him. So he really is a big, big man, great physique. And they won't be able to live in the same ring with him, and that's why they're avoiding him. McCall is a very aggressive fighter, and it's going to be a very tough fight. I think it's going to go the distance, because McCall's never been put down, and he's a very game fighter. I think Lennox will easily outbox him, outmaneuver him, and I think he'll easily win on points.
When you look back on that particular punch from McCall, how did you feel? Did your heart sink through to your feet?
I think the feeling is numb. You get to a stage where you see the punch. I've never seen Lennox on the floor. when you see him on the floor and he's getting up, it's all slow motion. It's like a bad dream, and you look at it, and it took a week to sink in, really, and it was terrible.
Don King, let me first of all have your thoughts on the weight. McCall at 237, Lewis at 251.
Well, McCall is on the money. He's in shape. I don't think Lewis is in shape. He's at 251. He's being excessive weight for a guy who's been demanding and said he's been waiting for 2 years for a fight. He certainly is taking it lightly to come in as big as George Foreman. So it'll be interesting to see whether or not Lennox Lewis can perform at that weight or not. However, I do believe that the promotion is what we call a doodlebug promotion. In America, we have a bug called a doodlebug. You put him on the line, you say, go, he goes backwards. Then they'd be lucky if they have anybody other than me and the cameraman at the fight. Don King has never missed a promotion in his career, close to 400,000 fights. Postponement every now and then, failure never.
Are we looking at the minds of the boxers here, Don? What's actually going through McCall's mind? What do you think is going to go through Lewis's mind?
McCall has one single purpose, to destroy Lennox Lewis. He has no other purpose. He's focused. He has the power of God in him now. He's religious. He's turned to religion because he was leading a worldly life, and it was one that was untoward and unsavory. And so he has that power of getting his mind with peace with God. So I would liken him to be the David going out to slay Goliath. You know what I mean? And so in this instance, this is what he's taking, powerful armament that he's taking with him into the ring. I think that Lennox Lewis is confused. I mean, he really don't know what direction he's coming from, so he don't know what direction that he is going. So it's a very difficult task for him because he has a lack of confidence in his handlers because they have made a really hodgepodge out of this whole affair, and he finds himself in a quandary.
Well, he's up for this fight. He's very mentally prepared for this fight. It means a lot to him. He's ready for every fight, but this fight has a certain edge to it because of all the politics, because of all the long wait, and because of the rivalry between Don King's camp and the Panics promotion team. So there may be a few extra sparks in this fight tonight, but we'll see at the end of the evening.
Don's told us that the only people coming to the fight will be Lennox and the camera crews. What would be your reaction?
Listen, as long as Oliver McCall turns up, I'm not worried who else turns up. The camera crews turn up, at least that means the rest of the world's going to see Lennox Lewis regain his heavyweight championship of the world. Don King's a master of propaganda and will spread as much as he can just to upset everyone, because he lost the vital court case and lost the purse bid, and he's a very bad loser.
What support are you expecting from England?
The English support is very good. I mean, around the hotel and around Vegas at this moment, the strip, I keep bumping into a lot of English people. I would say there's somewhere between 1,000 to 1,200 British people here.
Lennox has come in at 251 pounds for this fight, a little bit heavier than he's previously fought. Is this for any particular reason?
No, it's no concern of the camp. He's looking a lot bigger than he is. He doesn't look like he's carrying any fat anywhere. His face is nicely drawn and he looks like razor sharp. I've watched him train for 8 weeks. No, the weight is no problem to him. It's only about 3 pounds or 4 pounds heavier than he last fought, and that was 8 months ago, so that's not a lot of weight to put on. And plus, what people seem to realise is we've been in Vegas now for seven days. We'd finished all our serious training just before we left Arizona, and since we've been here, all we've been able to do is sort of do light workouts and more press work, so he's obviously going to put on a bit of weight while he's been sitting around the last few days.
Did you have Lennox on any special diet program?
No, I didn't. Lennox's diet mainly consists of chicken, fish, turkeys, a lot of white meat, a lot of protein, carbohydrates, baked potatoes, yams, corn, stuff like that, pasta. There's no special diet. We just eat and train.
So plenty of carbohydrates in the week coming into the fight then?
Yeah, we go a bit, we do a bit more carbs on the week leading up to the fight, but we tend not to eat a lot of pasta like a lot of the other people think. Oh, most people think that carbs are pastas, right? But there's other sources, and we mix and blend the whole thing and get it just right. We've been doing this now together for almost 7 years, so the weeks leading up to the fight, it's like, okay, it's time to go have fun.
Lennox's mother is a famous cook, isn't she? And I know she spent time at camp.
She's famous to us. She's fabulous. I tell her what I want Lennox to eat, and she does it up. I mean, you got to understand, we're eating chicken and fish and turkey for 9 weeks. So she makes it so that day in, day out, we can have these foods without getting sick of them.
Emmanuel Steward is well known for his vociferous part in the corner. What part do you play?
My basic role during the fight is to hand Harold the water, the spit bucket, and the stool. Take it from him when the round's over. My other thing is to time the rounds and give Lennox a signal when the round's coming to an end, so that he can better prepare without waiting for that last 10 seconds. Because during training, the clock that we use gives him a signal at 30 seconds. So I give him some sort of signal so he knows that, okay, 30 seconds left in the round.
In the last 3 weeks of training, Lennox has did two things. One, he's went to his highest level. He peaked, so to say. He boxed 10 rounds on three different occasions. I mean, 10 brutal rounds, too. And his training was to the point where he was running more than ever. And then after that, he started to slacken off. He's right now mentally in a good state of mind, physically good condition. We're very happy about the fact that he has no injuries going into the fight. In preparing Lennox for the rematch with Holland McCall, we have not dealt on any one particular style strategy, because he will not be fighting the same Oliver McCall that he fought 2.5 years ago. I think McCall has deteriorated a lot in a lot of ways, and Lennox has improved as an all-around fighter. But there's not any one particular style that we're prepared for, just Lennox Lewis improving his overall talent is enough for him to be not only McCall, I believe, any other heavyweight in the world.
How far have you travelled from for this fight?
Oh, many thousand miles, all the way from London, England.
Big Lennox Lewis fan then?
Well, definitely, yeah. I hope he'll win tonight. We think we will do.
I think he'll do it in four, maybe five.
Canada still takes Lewis to heart, don't they?
I think so. In general, I think you'd see they'd prefer Lennox for sure, but we'll soon find out, I guess.
Does McCall stand any chance?
No.
Well, I think Lennox in about the third, I think.
Well, he was very unlucky last time. I don't think there was any justice in that decision last time. I think, you know, he'll really go for it this time.
So only one person can win, and that's Errol Lennox.
Any doubts in your mind as to what's going to happen today?
No, I think Lennox will do the business, as they say.
No, I think he's going to get caught. I think he's going to get caught early. I think the first four rounds, if he does what he normally does and comes out slow, I think he'll get caught. And I've just put my money on him to do this very thing.
Time around, Emmanuel Steward was an all-over, now he's with Lennox. What does Emmanuel bring to the table?
I think Emmanuel's got a good style of calming him down, getting him to fight his fight a little more, making him fight the fight planned in training. I think he's more capable of doing that.
And as you can see, a large British contingency in here tonight to watch this fight, and there's Lennox Lewis making his walk to the ring. He's probably weighing about 254, 255 pounds today, maybe swinging about the same room. But he's got his working out for tonight.
Don't mean nothing. It's only when you get that ring. That's where everything turns.
When was the last time a heavyweight contending for the heavyweight championship literally ran into the ring the way McCall just did?
You think he was running away from a Don King check?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Las Vegas Hilton. All right, tonight, main events present 12 rounds of boxing for the vacant
WBC Heavyweight Championship of the World. In the blue corner, wearing black, weighing 237 pounds. Ladies and gentlemen, from the Windy City, Chicago, Illinois, introducing the WBC number two ranked heavyweight contender, the former WBC World Heavyweight Champion, the Atomic Bull, Oliver McCall. And across the ring in a red corner, wearing white trimmed with a Union Jack, weighing 251 pounds. He's a 1988 Olympic gold medal winner. From East London, England, presenting the number one ranked WBC heavyweight contender, former WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Lennox Lewis. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, your referee, Mills Lane. And now for the thousands in attendance and the millions watching around the world. This is the moment we've all been waiting for. From the Las Vegas Hilton, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble!
If you get ready, let's go to a right hand. Round number one. Hope for Lennox Lewis to be more active in his jab. Butt of the heads there by both guys. They both slid in with the heads. And Lou, how is the weight going to play a factor here towards the later rounds if you do see it?
By Lou Duva, Oliver McCall's never been knocked down, never been knocked down in a fight. Lennox Lewis going with the jab now. They're just two huge men in the ring right now, though, Lou, aren't they?
Yeah, just a little bit bigger. Or if he uses that left hand, it's going to be tough for this guy to get in there. He's going to have to walk in. Lennox will be throwing that right hand and coming back with a left hook. I'd like to see him go to the body.
Do you think McCall is sizing Lewis up the same way he did back in 94?
He's trying to get in. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to jab his way in and throw it right now. That's the only thing he can find
there. Lewis backing up Oliver McCall with a left jab, and the overhand right just goes right above the head but pushes him back still. Goes to McCall. I mean, Lewis in the black trunks. McCall in the black trunks. That jab. Doing the job here. McCall made a name for himself early on in his career as a sparring partner for Mike Tyson. He suffered a couple of losses in the fight before losing his recent title shot against Lewis, and now they're both at it again here tonight. This time we're fighting for an empty championship, and thus far it's been all Lewis with that jab. Here comes the final seconds of round number one. Two do the wrong ideas coming in line for Las Vegas tonight.
That's right, pulling him by his head, pulling him around, he took all of the aggression out of him, slowing him down. Now his man is really having a problem trying to figure out what to get away with that.
Good, it's a good shot. Every time, keep going to go. Don't worry about the power. Just keep playing with it. Keep playing with it.
What a
bang, bang, and keep playing with it.
Because this guy's trying to set you up. He's jabbing, he's out jabbing you. But you got to out jab him. Just take your time and you'll hit him. Don't be anxious trying to hit him with nothing big. Just use the jab, you'll see the big shot. You understand? Now, but stay on top of the guy. Keep him going back. Don't you go back. Because this guy can't fight too well going back. He can't throw punches. But if you let him come forward,
seconds out.
If you let him come forward, he's going to be able to hit you.
Mayor George Benton there, your old cohort, Lou. Oh, yeah. He's giving him the right advice.
He's giving him the right advice. But at the end of the day, the product does what the store is doing. He's going to do that to double the jab and keep it that hammer to the jab. There's no way he's going to do it. And if he does throw it in, he's going to hit it with right hand.
Lennox, you know that jab. You're finding a lot of success with it tonight. But he's really working for us. I've never seen him before.
Deep breath.
Because he's running at you with his eyes closed every time he comes in.
Here's a replay. The big uppercut there by Lennox Lewis. And looking at it again. The overhand right, big right, but McCall just comes right back into Lewis. Really back him up.
Great. Get back to the jab, kick your right hand up.
If I'm in the corner, I'm telling Lennox, jab. Let him walk in. Let him walk in through the right hand and come right back with left hook. Because McCall's walking right into him.
Does Lennox
Lewis have the mentality of a champion?
Sometimes you wonder. Sometimes you wonder. There's a lot of people wonder sometimes. And he's got the talent. He's got the talent to be the best heavyweight out there. But sometimes he just gets slacked on. You don't need
it. And as you can see, we mentioned the last round, the eye, the left eye is starting to swell up early. And now you can see where Lennox Lewis's left eye is starting to close up there.
See the other guy, the other guy's in desperation right
now.
He's throwing all them combinations. Hey, he's trying to get lucky. That's what we call
it. Ooh, good right there by Lennox Lewis. Backs up a call. The call goes right back into another left there by Lewis.
Yeah, that's really good. He's going to use that left hand. Now, him and as long as Lewis is driving his right hand.
Total unorthodox style on that. Championship of the world, and Adam McCall
jabbing him around. He shouldn't be trying to take him out with one punch. He should be jabbing him behind the body. Throwing combinations, that's what he should be doing.
It's almost as if McCall feels like he's being humiliated out of this.
No, I think he's trying to humiliate the sport of boxing. That's what I think he's trying to do.
Lewis has had two. Excuse me, Oliver McCall has had two. And the second time he's not even doing anything with the opportunity. They may stop this one in two rounds, right?
Absolutely.
McCall may not come out for round number five. This one may be over. Go to the corner for round number four.
As Oliver McCall refuses to defend himself, referee declaring a technical knockout at 55 seconds of round number five, the winner, and now a two-time WBC heavyweight champion of the world, the pride of Great Britain, Lennox Lewis.
I don't want to take anything away from Lennox Lewis's performance, because in our opinion, he would have beaten Oliver McCall. Even if Oliver McCall was at his best, or anybody was in front of Lennox Lewis tonight, he would have beaten him. I do want to say one thing, though. We have a lot of sympathy for Oliver McCall. Oliver McCall has some problems. Well, we're very mad at something, though. Oliver McCall should not have been allowed to fight tonight. He was not physically or emotionally ready to fight tonight. We hope Oliver McCall gets his life in order. We hope he becomes a good person in life. And if tonight's event helps that, we hope it works out in the best for Oliver McCall. The people that we're mad at are the people that allowed him to fight and told everyone that he was ready to fight, namely Don King, Lennox Lewis.
Thank you. has been a long time coming. It's been 2.5 years, and we've been to courts around the world trying to get into the ring and box for this belt. You know, I prepared myself with a great talented team. You know, I'm just going to defend this belt and hopefully go after the rest of the belts out there. I want to become undisputed heavyweight champion of the world.
All right, just one quick statement. Mark Ratner, the executive director of the Nevada Commission, will make a quick statement, I assume, regarding Oliver McCall.
So the commission is ordering the purse withheld. He will not be paid. We'll have a full commission hearing. We'll let him have his day in court, but he will not get paid for not honestly competing tonight. That is our statement.
You know, this is a great opportunity to get out and go and see Lennox fight, a British guy, let's go and support him. So that's what we did.
So what did you think of the fight?
I thought there was a lot of politics involved in the fight. I mean Lennox is a superb fighter, and you go like that. We come in to see him, we go, look, Lennox deserves this chance. He deserves to be the WBC champion. Do you know what I mean? But the other guy come in, and he's all like all over the shop. There's a lot of politics going on, and it's a lot of bollocks.
Well, first, you know, Lennox Lewis is a great champion, a total gentleman. And it was a great night for boxing and a horrible night for boxing. We saw a great champion with great dignity, manners, poise, style. And we saw a man who, in my opinion, had a mental breakdown in the ring. Boxing is in the dark ages when it comes to protecting the athletes.
I'm sorry the fight didn't turn out the way people expected to, because of the simple fact that the fight really wasn't over. I think that it was stopped prematurely, and once I explain, you can understand it. I hope so. So I said, well, my strategy was to go in there, and I was going to duplicate, really, I had intentions to duplicate what I'd done the first time when I was out, in having maybe a first or second round knockout. But then I was thinking to myself, I said, well, since I know Lennox's strategy, I said, if I don't knock him out in that second round, I'm going to have to go to some different strategic measures to neutralize what he was about to do, because I'm not going to have the same thing that happened to occur to me into the Frank Bruno fight, which it did, and he done it successfully. If he think that he can hit me, it would make him show himself. Now, in that third round, I threw a jab, and then invited him to hit me. He hit me. It did not faze me at all. It really did not faze me at all. He hit me to the body. I threw up my hands. Come on, I'm inviting him. Now, the referee, on the other hand, was looking at the fight and coming to a conclusion that I did not want to fight. It wasn't that I didn't want to fight. I could win that fight, and I could win it still. I know I could beat Lennox. Without a doubt, I could take everything he throw. It ain't no punch that he fear me with that I know. He hit me dead. If you look at it, he hit me dead on a button. This man hit me with all he got, and I'm still standing there. But y'all still, the ref, they did not give me an opportunity to play out my fight. I knew that after a round or two, Lennox wasn't going to realize in his mind that he can't do nothing with Oliver McCall. Everybody mind. Now, let's look at the fight. Y'all was looking like, why Oliver ain't punching? He ain't why. But then, as the fight went on, Lennox threw all the punches. I go duck. I let him, wow, okay, I'm here. He hit me to the body. Boom. Come on. The Lord is my very essence to live. Now, y'all can say that's rambling. Y'all can say he's going on. But the fact is, I don't do the things I used to do. And we all will be judged. We all will be judged. Because you're supposed to do unto your brother as you do unto you would have them do, if you would do unto yourself. And that's all I have to say with that.
what I'm going to say is what I said a few minutes ago. I think that Mr. McCall has been very articulate. He's told you what has happened. I think his mental state is just fine, and I think you can judge by what you saw and what you heard. That's really all I need to say about that.
Reg Gutteridge, the voice of boxing for, well, a long time, let's just say. Have you ever, in all your years, seen anything like that?
No, I thought I'd done it, seen it, got all the T-shirts, but this is a new one. You know, I mean, Duran actually quit in a fight, but this fellow didn't officially quit. So it's not no mass the second, really. No, I just can't well, I can understand it. I mean, you know, the guy's in need of help, and he had a mental breakdown in the middle of the fight. Lewis simply, you know, frustrated and took out the hell out of him. He didn't know what to do. And even before the fight, we were all saying, is he a bit manic, this fellow? And not just because of the troubles he'd been in, but the way he's been talking here as well.
On a Las Vegas radio phoning program this morning, callers are saying they want their money back. They want to hand in their ticket stubs. They want a refund.
It doesn't surprise me at all here. I mean, they're used to, you know, hard battles, aren't they? Muhammad Ali was beaten here by Leon Spinks. You know, I mean, there's been some great fights in this place, in this hotel, not just the town. And I can understand them, but again, you can't take it out of Lennox. I don't think they can withhold McCall's entire purse money because he wasn't disqualified. That's the only beef I would have, and I've got a lot of regard for Mills Lane, the referee, but I thought he should have disqualified him.
Were you aware that at the end of round four, McCall had told George Benton that he didn't want to carry on fighting and that when the referee came over, he changed his mind?
No, you know, I was basically in my corner with Emmanuel Stewart. He basically said, you know, just go over there and just beat him up because he doesn't want to fight. And he's very frustrated. He doesn't know what to do with your overall size and strength.
Did you feel any compassion for Oliver at all during this time?
Well, you know, at first when he started crying, I thought he was joking, trying to trick me into something. But then I realized, well, you know, if he's not mentally stable, he shouldn't be in the ring. He was physically prepared, but definitely not mentally.
Well, your left jab was there in his face all the time, and the right uppercuts were clearly getting through and hurting him.
Yeah, I mean, you know, anytime he sticks his face out, my combinations were there. I was slowly stepping it up. But, you know, when he first started walking around, I took my time. I just wanted to see what he was up to at first. Then I realized he was up to nothing. I just really just opened up some combinations on him. He couldn't really take the power of them. He felt the power of them, but I think he was more frustrated, didn't realize what, you know, what to do. I don't think the referee had any choice, really, because the referee's in there and he's in there as a security to make sure we don't kill each other.
Did you speak with Oliver after the fight?
Oliver took off. He jumped out of the ring. He took off. I think he was more disgusted in himself. He was still going through his mental problems. He usually comes in crying into the ring. This time he ran into the ring with a little cry, but he left crying. You know, my feelings are just natural. It hasn't really sunken in yet because, you know, I'm kind of used to this position. Basically, I've been trying to get this belt for 2.5 years, but it's, you know, we've been to courts around the world for the opportunity to fight for the belt, and we finally got it.
And full of adrenaline, and that can help you, and if you let it overcome you, it can be the worst thing possible for you. So it remains to be seen if he's loosened out yet, but he's a good fighter up close, and he's hit Lewis with a good right hand around the side and a left uppercut. Tried the right hand again, missed, and McCall came back with his own right hand to the body. This guy's very strong, very physically strong, Oliver McCall up close. So Lennox will not want to fight with him on the inside. That's where his best game plan will be. got to get him at a distance, use that quick jab and not allow him to get off on him.
The bull, they call him, he's built like an ox.
Yeah, built very strong indeed. And he's a great offensive fighter, which, as I said, if he gets over these first couple of rounds, could cause Lewis all sorts of problems. Lewis doesn't like to be forced back and doesn't like to lose the initiative, likes to take control of the fight, and this guy's forcing him to take a step back every now and again. Oh, Lewis tried that big booming right hand over the top. He wants a winning style here.
Just away from the chin. McCall took it well though, didn't flinch. Remember, McCall has never been down. First round close, but probably to Lewis, the jab working. And he just did enough to show it, I think.
Yeah, he just imposed himself a little bit more on McCall and looked just have shaded the round, very close round all the same.
So McCall there with his 24 wins out of 29 fights, 17 inside the distance, turned pro in 1985. He lost his first pro fight to Mike Hunter, but hasn't he come on since, and Lennox an unblemished record with 21 KOs. As we said, bang on, 238, 17 stone, his heaviest ever fighting weight. Pepe Correa in front of him, his main trainer, who was non-stop. The Lennox corner is just, 2 meters in front of where Barry and I are sitting. And Correa is constantly buzzing, exhorting his man on.
And Carrera said, let the jab be the key. Use the jab, that's the key to everything, which is absolutely right. You can't afford to get up and just load up on this guy without jabbing first, because, and Lewis is down! Oh, what a right hand! He's in big trouble here, Simon.
Just walked onto it, and he is in desperate trouble. His legs are shaky. It's over! It is over! Lennox Lewis has gone, and Oliver McCall is the new world heavyweight champion. Lennox is saying, what happened? Why did he stop it? But he was in no position to defend himself. One big right hand was enough. And it was McCall's night of destiny.
I think it was a situation where I exposed myself. You know, I just went out there and my mindset was just to go out there and destroy him, because, you know, he was shooting off his mouth in the earlier press conferences. I just wanted to go out there and land my right hand, because I knew if I put, all my power behind my right hand that and hit him, that it would all be over really quick. And I went out there and I threw a left hook and a right hand at the same time he was throwing a left hook. But, you know, not realizing the punch that he caught me with was a very natural punch for him, where, you know, he almost threw this punch in a fit of scaredness. He must have realized that my right hand was coming, and he just closed his eyes and moved like he naturally does and threw his right hand in return. At that time, my body was way in front of myself. And my balance is way ahead of myself, and he just caught me right on the button. And it's like I helped him to knock me down.
We're talking about this long road back. It was September 94, nearly 2.5 years to when you're getting back in the ring. Did you honestly think it was going to take you 2.5 years to get to the mat?
No. I felt that, okay, Oliver McCall would have one fight and then fight me once again, but with the trials and tribulations of boxing, this is how the politics and people can affect the sport. And there's all kinds of different things that have stopped me getting that one chance or that one fight back, obviously, with Oliver McCall, or even getting the WBC belt back. I think, in a sense, things happen for a reason. I can't really blame one thing.
What did you learn from that fight? Was it that you weren't undefeatable, that you weren't all-powerful, that you could lose?
Oh, yeah. Like I said, there's always that chance of me losing. I think I learned a great deal. it really helped me, because if I would have went through that fight and beat Oliver McCall, I think, you know, I may have gone down another bad road somewhere. So in a sense, this was like a teaching process for me. It helped me to realize the team around me wasn't as tight as I would have wanted it. My trainer wasn't as good as I thought he was. Not to totally believe in him, because he wasn't really the right trainer for me at the time. Certain people around me weren't the right people around me. And, you know, obviously making the right decisions and you know, correcting the world around Lennox Lewis and making it a lot better. So next time when I go in the ring, step in the ring, I have a stronger team around me that's going to help me, you know, get what I'm after.
And one of the positive things that came out of that, in talking about the team, is that the man who trained Oliver McCall for your next fight was in fact your trainer.
Yeah.
Emmanuel Stewart, who's trained 24 champions, I believe.
Yes.
What do you think he's done for you?
Emmanuel Stewart is, it's funny getting into professional boxing from the amateurs and going through one trainer, and that trainer will teach you a certain thing, then going through another trainer and he will teach you a certain thing. All of a sudden, reaching and getting with Emmanuel Stewart, it seemed like we were made for each other, because he had such a knowledge of the game, such experience out there, and he was one of the, he's a trainer that he would speak, and all of a sudden I would listen and I could understand and actually do what he would want, or what he was telling me to do.
All while I've been training the other heavyweights that I've had, Michael Moore and Evander Holyfield, I always, you know, let it be known to everyone that my favorite heavyweight in the world was always Lennox Lewis. And in fact, they used to even tease me about it, and Oliver McCall included. And when I got a phone call after the McCall and Lennox Lewis fight, I seriously thought about it for a moment. I had never made any verbal agreement or written agreement with any of the other heavyweights that I had trained to win championships, because I never really wanted to be tied down. And when I received a call related to training Lennox, I thought about it for a while, even though at the time I was handling the heavyweight champion of the world, which was Oliver McCall. And I looked upon it as a challenge. And I went to meet with Lennox and Panos Eliades and Frank Maloney. And after the meeting, I had a good feeling. And we worked out in a gym. It's very good chemistry between Lennox and I. And I decided that I was going to do it and give up Oliver McCall, who was a heavyweight champion, because I believe that Lennox would win the championship again, and it would be a chance for me to go on and really to take one major project and see if I can make him become the best all-around heavyweight in the history of boxing. When Lennox and I was training for the first fight together, which was with Lionel Butler, which was his first fight following the defeat to Oliver McCall also, you could tell there was still a lot of uneasiness and unsureness about him. Because in fighting Butler, who was mandated as the mandatory guy that he had to fight in order to get a chance to fight back for the title, he was fighting a guy who was also promoted and handled by Don King, basically known as a street-type person who had no discipline, who was basically in a lot of ways very similar to Oliver McCall. And when we got to the ring that night, it was the same type situation. The guys that was in his corner, one of them was his former trainer, Pepe Carrera, who said some very derogatory things to him in the center of the ring, which I thought was disgusting. And you could tell that Lennox, based on all of this, was really very uncomfortable with the entire situation. And he was not sure of himself, neither, until I think about two rounds before he finally got his confidence up. And then he went to work. I think that was the most difficult fight that he's had in his career at this point in time right now.
In a sense, it was a little difficult because, you know, coming off of a knockout, people felt that, oh, Lennox Lewis's chin isn't there anymore. And everybody expected Lionel Butler to come out there and knock me out and do the same thing. So I was, in a sense, apprehensive in a way. I didn't really want to get hit, but yet go out there and prove that I can outbox Lionel Butler, and that Lionel Butler really wasn't nothing to me. And It was a big step for people said, because, you know, they say, why would I go in against a guy that, you know, was known for knocking people out? I wanted to really prove myself and prove that, you know, the day with Oliver McCall was a lucky punch, and that Lennox Lewis still has a great chin and can go out there and still win and still is a champion.
This is round number five. A lot of water in the corner of Lionel Butler. Quick knockdown. Caught Lionel Butler, I believe, off balance. His feet were together. I don't think he was really hurt. Flash knockdown in the early part of this round. Lewis pawing with the jab. Notice when he throws his jab, folks, he doesn't bring it back like he should. When you throw your jab, you should bring it back to your chin like it was on a rubber band. But Lennox drops his jab, a la Tommy Hines, that's how you get countered with the right hand. Lennox trying to hammer home that right hand. Getting mugged inside a little bit. Marty Denken warning Butler for his brawl. Whoa! What was that? Lionel Butler threw a good haymaker and fell down. That's what happens when you throw those haymakers with your feet together. Lennox Lewis landing his most powerful punches in the last round and then knocking Lionel Butler down at the beginning of this, the fifth round. Butler backing up a lot now, sucking wind. Starting to show some swelling around the right eye. Little note on Lionel Butler. He was the number one pick to play Mike Tyson in the HBO movie. This came out a couple months ago, last month. And the bottom line was, although he looked like Tyson when he was about 30 pounds lighter, he couldn't act to save his life. And he broke the other actor's nose in the very first round of practicing for the movie. So he was out. Butler not doing much. Is he trying to lure Lennox Lewis in? Lennox going with the left right there. All Lennox Lewis in this fifth round. Scheduled for 12, a WBC heavyweight title eliminator. I'm Pedro Fernandez. It's a pleasure to call the action for you tonight live from the Arco Arena in Sacramento, California. Seconds ago in this, the fifth round, scheduled for 12. Lewis already won this round. I wouldn't call it a round that he would put in the album. In fact, here comes the crowd getting on him. They want to see some action.
It's been a hard road to get back there because we believe we were cheated out of the World Heavyweight Championship. I've watched it over and over again. I've listened to the radio comments over and over again on it. And I would say it was more of a shock. If you actually study the fight and slow it down into slow motion, you will see McCall actually threw the shot in desperation. His eyes were closed and he was going backwards. And Lennox had committed himself. And McCall's natural punch, if you watch any of his fights, is just to throw a right hand. And he just threw the right hand. And unfortunately, Lennox Lewis had committed himself and come off balance and had fallen forward. And there was only one place McCall's right hand could go, and that was straight onto Lennox's chin. And that's where it landed up.
I think that Lewis is going to win by a distance fight, points decision, or late stoppage.
And there, with no hype at all attached, just total meaning. This is the moment of destiny, perhaps, for Oliver McCall from Chicago. The number one challenger, can Lennox see him off? The referee from Mexico, Jose Guadalupe Garcia. three judges who will judge this fight. Well, first off, the Atomic Bull hasn't come charging out.
No, he's not. He's not his usual hyped up aggressive self. He's playing it safe at the moment. Blinking and frowning there at Lewis. Lewis, again, taking the centre of the ring. They're just pawing at each other, trying to measure their distance. And Lewis had tried to load it up with a good left hook there. McCall, unusually going back and using his jab, trying to be smart. I did see that, you know, they told us that he was going to run out and attack Lewis from the start, but that's something like Emmanuel Stewart would tell you. He gives you the wrong tactics completely. He's a great strategist, and obviously this guy's going to play a little cuter again. But Lewis effectively using that jab.
It must be murder for McCall to have these tactics. He's instinctively such an aggressive fighter and so charged up as he is to play it so contained.
Yes, well, he looks so charged up, and it must have been difficult for them to get him to do this in the first few rounds, but they're looking a little bit apprehensive there when he attacked Lewis. Lewis looks as poised as ever and in control.
Yes, I don't think the emotion's left McCall yet. It may do in a couple of rounds, but he's still very, very tight.
Yeah, he's stiff and